Hey, welcome back to Grit Gym. Today is 6:20, I do believe. We're in June 20th, so it's Wednesday. You're coming down to the show again. Yesterday we had a really good show with Rachel. A little bit more on the mindset category, some law of attraction stuff. And today we're going to go a different direction because this is one of these things where I'm listening to other podcasts. I hear people talk, and I'm wondering, the question that is rolling around in my head is the word love actually become cliche? And I want to, like, throughout this presentation, try to think from a standpoint of skepticism, of questioning, not necessarily a blind faith to what you fill the word container love with. Because if we think of words like containers, how are we filling each container? So you like, if you raised a kid and you always called a book a banana and the pages peels, that kid would grow up thinking that a book was called a banana. Like, the word banana meant book. How you fill the word book would be how he fills the word banana, and how he fills the word peel, you would fill that container with pages. So think like that. Like, what does the word love really mean? Because I listen to a lot of podcasts, I read a lot of books, and I have yet to come across a book that gives a very clear definition of the word love, a very, very clear a version of love. What does it mean to you? Because I'm going to give some examples that are not so pretty. They're not so pretty with how somebody has filled the word love. I think if this is the most important word in our dictionary, if this is the most important word in our world, if everybody puts so much value on it, if all you need is love, then let's get very, very clear on what that means. Is it sex? Is it a relationship? Is it love for yourself? Is it being present? Is it being mindful? Is it respecting others? Is it, what does love mean to you? And I think of this from a very pragmatic standpoint. I don't get really idealistic when it comes into this scenario of love. I try to look at it from an analyst. And some people might say, like, oh, well, then you're missing out on the emotion of it all. Like, am I? Am I? If I'm getting extremely clear what this word means, because as I go through some of these, for instance, let's just go through one. Let's go through one real quick. Let's go to the most dramatic thing, and I'm going to do three different stories, and I'm going to ask you, is this love? Okay, and it might not be your version of love, but to the people in these stories, it is love. So, for instance, there's a little girl and a mom sitting on a, like right now, somewhere, there's a little girl and a mom sitting in a room. The mom is crying because the dad just flew off the handle, smacked the mom across the face, and it's awful thing. And the little girl is really scared and confused, and her mom is crying, and the little girl says some version of asking, you know, why did her dad do that? And the mom is replying, right now, this is happening, the mom is replying, it's just because he cares so much. It's just because he loves us so much that he can't contain it. Now, this is, like, to me, that's not love. But to that little girl, she just got an explanation that love is justified abuse. That you're justifying abuse because somebody is so passionate. That's what that mom thinks of as love. Now parents scream this all the time. They say they beat their kids and they say it's for your own good. Well, is it? I think we got to sit down and we really got to question this thing. Like, what is love? Because your words are very important, and how you use them clearly is very important. How you use them is how you're going to think about them, and how you think about them is how you're going to use them. Your words tell a great deal of the inner workings of your mind. How you think is going to be reflected by how you speak. And you get around me for a couple seconds, a couple minutes, and I'm going to be able to point out a few of the projections that you have made that might not be accurate, but they are perspectives, and they might be something to roll around in your brain. Anyway, to this little girl, that is justified abuse. And there's also a little boy somewhere that is just as sad. There's a little boy somewhere riding in a car with his dad who is trying to keep it together. The dad is trying to keep it together after just being completely torched by his wife and manipulated and beat down and yelled at and screamed at, maybe physically harmed. And the dad took the son to try to get it out of the mom's kind of area so that the mom could calm down and do her thing, and so the son didn't have to. And the dad's trying to keep it together, and the little boy is scared and confused also, and he's wondering, why does mom act like that? Why does mom do that? And that dad is saying, right now, this is happening. The dad said, it's because she cares so much. It's because she loves us so much. And to that little boy, his his explanation of love, the definition of love that he has received at that point, is that justified abuse is love. Now, that to me, that's not love. To you, that might not be love, but to those kids, that is love. So let's get very, very clear on what our definition of love is and how we're filling that word, because there's a bunch of people out there right now that are going to go, those, that little girl and that little boy are going to grow up and they're going to find somebody that provides them the love that they think they deserve. And they're going to think that they deserve that kind of love. And that's sad. That's tragic. That's sad. That's so, that's like heart-wrenching that happens, but it happens all the time because they never explored other perspectives on love. And you might have a great definition of love. Your experience with love might be absolutely fantastic. You know, like you go and talk to Rachel about what she thinks love is, and it's just this amazing thing. But if you would have talked to me about what I thought love was 10 years ago, I'd have told you it's some version of sex. Now, that's ridiculous. That has nothing to do with it. So what we're going to get into here is, what does it mean to love like a man? And I will say one thing that can clear up love real quick is anything that you can purchase with money, anything that you can purchase with acts, anything that you can purchase with acts of service, money, time, any of that stuff, anything that you can buy has nothing to do with love, and that includes sex. And I realize that that's not a very nice thing to say, neither were the last two stories that I said. So it's hard things to think about, but we have to get very, very, very clear. So those last three things that I just said that weren't so great, they are to create a dramatic effect so that you start thinking of things differently, so that you don't end up becoming the parent that says some version of, you know, it hurts me more than it hurts you. Like the parent who tells the kid, it hurts me more than it hurts you to give you a spanking. It hurts me more than it hurts you to get angry and smack you across the face. It hurts me more than it hurts you to throw you across the room. By all means, if that's the way that you care for somebody, then don't go caring for me. And if it does hurt you more than it hurts the kid, please stop doing that thing. Stop hurting yourself. That's three bouts of self-victimization. It's a ridiculous explanation. It hurts me more than it hurts you when I hit you. It's just this, the hit was self-victimization. Two, the blame was self-victimization. And three, to justify it was self-victimization. It's pathetic. It's a pathetic thing that you hear on a regular basis. But what does it mean to love like a real man? Because I don't think any of those things that I just said were love. Not to me. Like, what does it mean to love like a real man? My definition of love is that I'm present and that's enough. In this moment, I can do my absolute gut-wrenching best. Okay, that's what it means to be enough. In this moment, I am enough to do my absolute gut-wrenching best. And the fact that I live in this moment and did my absolute gut-wrenching best in this moment meant that I practice self-love. And if I practice self-love and I get really good at this thing and being in the moment and being here and being conscious and living my life like this in this conscious way where I'm very much right here, right now, conscious of the words that I'm using, the actions that I have, and the people that I'm surrounded by, now I can express outward love because I've expressed inward love. I have this internal and external focus thing going. That's kind of the definition is I'm present and that's enough. Everything else was me explaining how I kind of think about it. But when it comes to loving like a real man, so if you're going to use that definition that I just used, when it comes to loving like a real man, I think there's a few things, and I'm going to expand on this as I go further. And throughout life, I'm going to grow and expand upon these as I go anyway. So 10 years from now, if I haven't expanded upon the perspective that I'm going to give in this presentation, then I screwed up. But I really think number one thing, it has to be you first. It has to be you first. And I mean this from two different perspectives, two really big different perspectives. You first in the love category. If you're going to love like a real man and you first is the goal, then self-love is the thing. Loving yourself first. You first means you love you first. Before your wife, before your kids, before everything else, there is you. If you don't take care of you, you are not of service to anybody that you care about, and you are not going to be able to do the things that make you great. Okay, you have to put you first. You are the most important. Like two perspectives on the significance thing. To the universe, you are not significant whatsoever. You are a in time. You are just absolutely nothing. You are completely insignificant. However, to you, you are the most significant thing that will ever exist. To your family, you are fairly significant. To your friends, you are fairly significant. But to the universe, you are not significant. You have to love you first. You have to put as much love towards you as you possibly can, because then you can care for all those around you in the way that you want. The other thing about the second thing about the you first perspective is that a leader has muddy boots. The first time that I remember hearing this quote, man, it hit me like a ton of lead. I don't remember where I was or what I was doing. I just remember sitting in that moment and being like, a leader has muddy boots. Like, if I want to be the leader, I have to do the thing. Do you get what I'm saying? You go around on social media and you're going to see people spread love, don't spread hate. You know, that's fantastic. But if you're going to do that, the best possible way to actually spread love and to dispel hate is to live it, to actually be the thing. A leader has muddy boots. You have to go first. You have to be the one to go out and figure out what is love, what's it mean to you, get very, very clear on how you use it and in what capacity it is. Not what type of love is it? What love language are you? Really, when you get into the love languages, I think it's more about a receiving thing than a giving thing. Like everybody's supposed to have their primary love language. No, I think the mistake about the love languages, or the misunderstanding around the love language, is that you're not looking for all of the different ways that love is coming at you. So like me, it's quality time. I put quality time above all else. It doesn't mean that I don't like acts of service, or I don't, like, I have a tough time accepting gifts. So that's one of the ways that I need to practice accepting love from other people. What are the others? I don't know. But the five love languages are about how you accept love, not like how you're going to give love and manipulate people with it. So that's the number one is you first. You have to love you first, and loving yourself has nothing to do with liking yourself. I think that there's a great divide there. I don't like everything about me, but I'm not going to put conditions on if I love myself or not. Like, if I want to get into the light game, well, I don't like it that my shoulders aren't 6 inches wider. I don't like it that my ankle is not proportionate to my wrist. You know what I mean? Like, I would love to look like Popeye, you know, like have this huge, big body. That's when you get into that like crap. Like is a completely different scenario than love. I'm not going to put conditions on my love for me, and then therefore I will be less likely to put conditions on other people's ability to give me love or receive love from me. So anyway, to move on past that, the number two thing is there's a difference between being positive and being nice. Okay, when it comes to love, now if I talk with this, I was just up at Liberty High and I was helping out the wrestlers there with their strength program, and we were talking about this. I have three big things that athletes, if they or anybody that's working with me, you do these three, we will get along very, very well. If you don't do these three, we're going to have a really tough time. In fact, I'm just going to stop working with you. I'm not going to continue. So number one is you have to work hard to improve. I do not care where you start. I do not care if you're the best athlete in the world or you're the worst athlete in the world, or I don't care. I don't care how bad or good you are. We can always improve. We can always move the barometer, or whatever you want to call it. We can always move the envelope. We can always push forward. You have to work hard to improve. If you do not work hard to improve, I'm not going to do this. Number two is to focus on the present priority. I almost got out of order. You can be focused, and the example I gave is like, let's say that I use this with high school kids. Let's say that your main crush is up in the front row, you're in the back, and the teacher happens to notice that you are focused on your crush rather than what's on the board, and the teacher says, "You're not focused." Well, that teacher is wrong. You are perfectly well focused. You just happen to be focused on the crush and not on the boring crap that the teacher is writing on the board. So let's get clear. What is the priority? Is the priority what is being learnt on the board, or is the priority the crush? I don't really have an opinion on which one you should pick. I'm saying decide. Focus, figure out what the present priority is, and then decide that thing. And number three is to be a positive influence. And we always go over this. Positive doesn't mean nice. Being a bad partner is telling someone good job when they didn't do a good job. Being a bad partner is telling someone good job when they didn't do their absolute best. Being a good or bad partner is indulging in somebody's with somebody in their self-victimization, like, oh, okay, it wasn't your fault. Yes, it was. Why would you rob them of this responsibility? Being positive does not mean being nice. Now, that doesn't mean that they can't overlap. Like, if they did do a good job and they did do their absolute best and they took full responsibility, then fuck yeah, tell them great job. But if they didn't, then don't. Be positive does not mean be nice. And that gets into the next thing. If you love, like, this is what I think when it comes to loving like a real man, if you really loved, like, from a coach's perspective, then discipline is not punishment. Then you will not accept self-victimization from the people around you or yourself. You will not accept less than your absolute best from yourself or from other people around you. And you will confront those around you, but you will confront instead of combat. You will not attack them, you will confront them if you love. And if you love, you'll add pressure upon anybody who has expressed that they want to get to a certain degree of excellence. And I think if you don't do those, you don't love. And some people think that I'm a little bit harsh when it comes to that. But to me, like, that might be harsh. It might be, it is, like, you got to be a little bit of a, like, it's going to be hard to discipline someone instead of punish someone. For one, you're one going to get angry and punish them. And for two, so that's tough. But for two, like, when you're not angry, it's really hard to stay in that discipline route of, no, this is what we agreed to, and you violated that agreement, so this is what the consequence is. That's very, very, very hard to do. Also is a confrontation when you're trying not to get angry at that person. So if you get angry, you go to combat and you attack. If you confront, you can confront without going to that attack. That's a loving scenario. You can confront without combat. No one says that you have to go to combat. Everybody says that you are, but confrontations are inevitable. They are going to happen. So we have to get more skilled at this. If you love, you can confront instead of going combative. And if you love, you will not accept self-victimization. You will not accept that somebody else is like, oh, poor you. You won't accept that. You'll call that ridiculous. You'll say, well, like, let's get back up and let's roll. You will not accept that. I'm not saying that you can't pat somebody in the back and say, like, that sucks, but we're not going to stay here forever. Okay, I'm not saying that you act like a jerk. That is not what I'm saying at all. I'm saying that you will not accept less than someone's absolute best. And I'm not talking about better than their best. I'm talking about their best. If you love you, you will not accept less than your best. If you love somebody else, you will not accept less than their best. Like, to me, I think that like, these things mean a great deal to me in what it means to love like a real man. And to some people, they might think that sounds harsh. But think of the alternative to everything that I just said. If you never practice loving yourself before loving others, if you never have the courage to be the leader and to have the muddy boots, if you aren't like, if you are the bad partner and just say good job at anything and everything, like, think of, like, that is harsh. What if you don't? What if you accept? What if you go? If you like, harsh is punishment. Harsh is combat instead of confrontation. It's punishment instead of discipline. It's accepting self-victimization. It's accepting that somebody's, like, lower level of what they could have achieved. It's like, harsh is robbing someone of something that they could have done for them, their self. Like, that sounds like the harshest thing that I can possibly imagine. So I don't think it could sound harsh if you want to use that perspective. But I think it's tough. I think it's strong. I'm not talking about screaming and yelling. I'm talking about confrontation. I'm talking about loving yourself enough to confront instead of combat, to add pressure, to discipline instead of punish, not accepting things that are not acceptable, and to putting you first. You are always the first to go. You are the first to confront yourself. You are first to confront your own demons. You are the first to be the leader to go into anything. You cannot ask a kid to do, like, if you're a parent, you cannot ask a kid to do something that you are not willing to do. And I think that a lot of parents, like, there's a lot of these books, like, a lot of these, like, kind of psychological books where the parent goes to the psychologist or the guru or whatever and asks, like, will you put my kid through your thing? And the parent and the guru says, no, but I'll put you through it. And the parent's like, well, I don't get why I would go through it. They talk for a while. And then they're like, okay, well, the parent agrees to go through it. And while the parent is going through it, the kid just, like, almost by osmosis improves. Okay, so I think there's a lot there. If you take care of you first, you're at of better service to everybody that you care about in more ways than you know, and you're better at all the things that make you great. But anyway, that's what I think of when I think, what does it mean to love like a real man? Well, let's get clear on what the word love means. And then number one, you have to go first. You have to love yourself first, and I'm not talking about liking yourself. I'm talking about loving yourself, and then you have to be the leader. A leader has muddy boots. As the leader, you are the first one to go. And then being positive doesn't mean being nice. If you love, you will discipline instead of punish. You will not accept self-victimization less than anybody's absolute best. You will also confront instead of going to combat and attacking someone, and you will add pressure to any situation because you know that that will help. Anyway. Thanks for being here, guys. This is the first episode of the Lift Like a Real Man, or Love Like a Real Man. We did the suicide one last week, and it went over really well. I got a lot of messages. It was kind of interesting because we didn't boost that one or anything. But anyway, thanks for being here. I really appreciate it. If you made it this far, way to go. But let me know what you think. Anyway, be back tomorrow. Eric and Adam Show.